The beauty of Ethernet IP is it's just a bunch of lookup tables that are defined by a standard. A manufacturer just fills in the table with their product's information. The standard calls the first level of tables classes. All of this information we saw here in the previous video came from the identity class. The vendor of the GS4 drive filled in the identity class table with this data to create an object that our system could talk to. Because this is all predefined in the standard, the app knew where to go look for it and automatically retrieved it for us. Let's manually go in and look at the identity class so you can see how it's structured. This video assumes you have Ethernet IP set up from the previous videos and you're in remote mode on the drive. If I left click on the object and then right click, we can add a class to the tree below. The identity class is always class number one. Each class can have one or more predefined instances or tables of information. This identity class only has one. If I left click on this instance of the identity class, the app goes out and pulls in all of the data, which we call attributes, and shows them to us. Again, this table is well defined, and it's the same for every device, so the app knew how to go retrieve it and decode it. To do it manually, we just left click on the instance and right click to add whichever attribute we want. The first attribute is always 2 bytes, which represents the vendor ID. This is the lower byte, so it counts from 0 to 255. This is the upper byte, so it counts by 256s. So this says 2 256s and 148 ones, which is 660 decimal. Sure enough, if I click on the original object, we see that that is in fact the vendor ID. The sixth attribute is always the serial number. So that's 69 ones, 19 256s, 18 256 squareds, and 35 256 cubes, which is this, which is exactly what we saw back here. So again, when we clicked up here, this Ethernet IP Explorer app automatically pulled all of these attributes, did the numerical conversions, and displayed them here. So this is just a nice, neat presentation of what's actually in the identity class. Now what if we want to see the drive's frequency or current draw or bus voltage? Or what if we want to control the drive, tell it to run, stop, change speed? Well, that's in the assembly class, which is class number 4. Assembly classes are device specific, so the Ethernet IP Explorer app can't automatically pull the data in like it did for the identity class. So let's build it out manually and see what it looks like. Left click on the class, then right click to add an instance. I know the input buffer is instance 101. Which attribute do we want? Turns out there's only one input buffer, and its attribute number is 3. If I left click on that attribute, the Ethernet IP Explorer app goes out and reads the entire buffer and shows it to me. I know this is the bus voltage, and if I hit F3 to refresh the screen, I can see the bus voltage fluctuate. Now what is that bus voltage? Well, it's this many 256s and this many 1s, which is this. Exactly what we expect if we add in the implied decimal. You're probably wondering about now how I know those 2 bytes are the bus voltage. Or for that matter, how did I know which class was the identity class and which class was the assembly class? And how did I know the input buffer was instance 101? How did I know all that stuff? Well, it's easy. There's a cheat sheet and Appendix B of the user manual. In my early copy of the manual, the Ethernet IP section starts on page B17, where we see the general specs, all the Ethernet IP card identifiers, the pinout, the LED indicator descriptions, error codes, and the drive parameters you need to set up the Ethernet IP, which we did in the previous video. Here's the Ethernet IP implicit messaging details, the format of the input and output buffers, and finally, the explicit messaging, which we're using in this video. That is, we're explicitly opening up a TCP connection to the drive and requesting exactly what we want. Look, here's a list of the classes. And sure enough, we see the identity class is number 1 and the assembly class is number 4, exactly what we did a minute ago. If I scroll down to the identity class, I see there's one instance and it's number 1 and it has these attributes. We used attribute 6, for example, the serial number, in our example just a minute ago. This table is the services. This says we can only read and reset. There's no write ability for the identity class, which makes sense. We wouldn't want to overwrite the serial number or the vendor ID, right? Now, in some apps, you'll have to tell them which service to use. This Ethernet IP Explorer app that we're using right now, it does it automatically for us. Let's scroll down to the assembly class. He's class number 4 and has 3 instances. We used instance 101 before, which was the input buffer. That's the data into us, which is out of the GS4 drive. Instance 100 is the output buffer, which is the data out of us into the drive. Input and output in Ethernet IP is always relative to the originator, which in our case is the PC that we're originating the messages from. How did I know earlier that bytes 10 and 11 of the input buffer were the DC bus voltage? Well, that was back here in the buffer definition chart. Sure enough, the DC bus voltage is word 5, which is bytes 10 and 11. We can view any of these attributes, drive frequency, output current, run status, etc. Let's go ahead and open up instance 100 of the assembly class, which we know from Appendix B is the output buffer, so we can control the drive. Left-click on the instance, then right-click to tell it we want attribute 3, which we know from the chart gets and sets an array of bytes. Click on that, and we see the output buffer. The output buffer table says the second word, which is bytes 2 and 3, sets the drive frequency. Suppose we want 45 Hz. There are 2 implied decimal places, so we need a 4500 decimal. That's 17 256s and 148 ones. Sure enough, the drive is set to run at 45 Hz. The buffer definition table also says if we set this bit in the first word, which is a decimal 2, the drive should start running. And sure enough, it does. It says if we set bit 5, which is a decimal 32, the drive should reverse direction. And it does. Set bit 4, which is a 16 decimal, and the drive goes back to forward. Set bit 1, and the drive stops. Perfect. Now, would you normally enter a 2 to get the drive running like I did here? Well, no, because you don't know which direction the motor is going to rotate. It's much better to say, I want the drive to run and go in the forward direction, so we would enter an 18 here instead of a 2. Or, to run in reverse, we would enter a 34. Well, that should be enough to get you started with Ethernet IP on the GS4 drive. A couple side notes about using this Ethernet IP Explorer app. First, if you see a little red exclamation point here, it means it went offline. So just click on the object to refresh it, and then go back and click on the attribute again. The reason it went offline is there's a 100-second timeout which you can change under Settings. For this video, I changed that timeout to 10,000 seconds so it wouldn't time out. Also, when I initially created this interface, that doesn't always seem to work for me. When it doesn't, I just kill the app, restart the app, and try again. It usually works after I do that once or twice. Click here to learn more about GS4 drives. Click here to learn more about AutomationDirect's free support options. And click here to subscribe to our YouTube channel so you're notified when we publish new videos.